Hi, this is Gary with MACMOST.com. This is part two of my course, The Practical Guide to Mac Security. This course is brought to you free thanks to my Patreon supporters. To find out more, go to MACMOST.com/Patreon. So I'm going to start this course by talking about passwords. Passwords are perhaps the most fundamental part of your Mac, computer, device, and internet security. Without strong passwords, all other security measures don't mean much, since with a weak password, it's easy for someone else or an organization to break into one of your accounts. So to understand why you need strong passwords, it's important to understand how an account is broken into. The main method that is used is simply brute force. This means trying over and over again to break into an account. Any internet account has three parts to it. The first part is simply the service itself. So this could be a shopping site. It could be your bank's website. It could be a site like Facebook. Now for your individual account, you've got an ID. This is almost always your email address. Email addresses are unique. That's why they make good IDs. IDs have to be unique. Your name probably isn't unique. There's probably somebody else with your name. Coming up with your own ID, it's going to be hard to come up with an ID that's unique. But email addresses are unique. If you've got your email address, nobody in the world has that same email address. So they make really good IDs, and also they're good because they're hard to forget. So you can't forget your ID because it's your email address. Now the third part, of course, is the password. With these three things, the target site, your email address, the ID for your account, and the password, if somebody has those three things, they can get into your account. So the target is always going to be a property of some value. Bank is always a common example, but social media accounts, email accounts, the account set up on your computer, your iCloud account, these are all good examples. Shopping sites like eBay and Amazon, all good examples. There's some value to having access to somebody else's account on these targets. Your email address, the second part, is easily available. If you've ever gotten a single piece of junk email, that means your email address is out there. And everybody's gotten some junk email. If you don't think you have, look in your junk folder. And if you still don't find it in there, it's probably because your internet service provider has filtered them out before they come to you. Lists of email addresses are out there. Your email address is public information, just like the street address for your house. Anybody walking by your house can see that. So the only real security is your password. And if you have a weak password, brute force could be used. A combination of the target site with your email address, which can come off a list of everybody's email address, and a password that you use that is weak can be tried. And if successful, they've broken into your account. Now, what are the chances that they're going to guess your password? Well, pretty remote, except that they can try again and again and again. Using brute force, they can try millions of times, trying all sorts of weak passwords to try to get in. They can do this because they're not just using one computer. They're usually using networks of computers. Sometimes computers that have malware on them that have been turned into servants of the malicious people that want to break into accounts. So you have all these computers all around the world trying a service, an email address, and a password, and just over and over again, and trying to get a certain number of accounts that they can hack in a given time period. So try, and try again is how brute force works to break into your account. Another way that they can break in is with a data breach. So a data breach is when you have those same three things, target site, email address, and password, but the email address and password come from a list. This list is from when there's a data breach. So sometimes you hear about a big company, maybe a retailer or online service, they have a data breach. They say somebody got to all our data. This could include email addresses and passwords. Now when you hear about this, you're told to change your password at that site or service. Sometimes you get an email directly from them telling you to do that, and you may think, okay, I've changed my email address for that service, so I should be safe. But a lot of people reuse passwords. So if you've used that same email address and password on another site, they can break into that other site. So in other words, site A, you're using the same password as site B. Site A has a security breach. So your password for site A is out there, but you change your password for site A. But you forget that on site B, you're using the same email address and password. And they're going to try that email address and password combination at that site. It's a lot easier, given a data breach list like this, for them to get in. And not all data breaches are reported. A lot of them are not. So a site that you signed up for that you didn't even think was important, maybe you don't even use it anymore, that site got a data breach. You never even heard about it. And that password you're using at another site that is important, and now that site's broken into. And they'll try again to use this data breach information to get into different accounts. And they're usually pretty successful. A third way to do it doesn't involve weak or strong passwords, because any password is vulnerable. And it's social hacking. You've got the same three things that are needed, but in this case, they're going to use you and con you out of your email address and password. And this doesn't need any kind of brute force. They can do it in one try. We'll talk about that later on in the course and how to avoid that. So even strong passwords will have their limits. Now, in order to get a strong password, you need to understand what a weak password is. So what is a weak password? Well, first, it's any dictionary word, any word that's in a dictionary. Now keep in mind, even though there are only about 80,000 words in English, which seems like a really low number if you think about it, 80,000 words, 80,000 passwords, take no time at all for a computer to run through them and try all those words as passwords. But in fact, most of those are technical terms and things like that that we don't normally use. Everybody uses about 10,000 words, so it's really easy to go through those words and try them as passwords, even combinations. So things like this for passwords, they may be great because you can easily type them and you can easily remember them, but they will easily be broken. Your account will be broken into if you use something like this. Even combinations of words like let me in or my pass, things like that, where there's more than one dictionary word in there, easily broken when they try to break into accounts. Also, variations. You may think you're being clever by using a 0 instead of an O, or a 5 instead of an S, or even an exclamation point instead of a 1 or an I. These can be easily broken too, because they know all these tricks and they're going to try the word dragon with an O and dragon with a 0 and all other variations you could possibly dream up. It's not hard for them to add these to the list and try these variations. Also, names and places. So you might want to have your password be the name of a loved one. But there are fewer names than even regular dictionary words. Even if you throw in place names and teen names and variations and things like that, these are also things that are tried. Just imagine a huge list of potential passwords, millions and millions of passwords that other people have tried that are combinations of words and things. These are all going to be tried with your email address to break into your accounts. Also, dates. People try to use dates, but in fact, there aren't that many dates. 365 days a year, and most dates that we try to use are either without the year or maybe within the past 50, 60, 70 years, like birthdays and anniversaries and such. And there's only so many formats. It really isn't hard to try all of these different dates, and no matter how clever you think you're being trying to use a different date format, they're going to be things that are easily broken, and combining words with dates as well. Anything easy to type also is on this list, like 123456, QWERTY, just repeating the same character over and over again, or things that are all in the same row on a keyboard. These are all things that they are going to try to break into your accounts. So the last piece here that makes up a weak password: even if a password looks strong, it's weak if it's not unique. So what's not unique? Any password you've used before. You should only use a password at one site once, and that's it. Once you've changed that password, never use it again. Never use it at a second site. And a password anybody else has used before. So this is, of course, you would know, but if you're going to be using a random password, then chances are it's never going to be used before. any words or phrases from TVs, movies, books, anything like that, just weird things that you've heard being used as passwords or combinations or anything, that's not unique. And think of if it exists somewhere else in some form, if it's been written, spoken in any way, then it's not unique. Then it's something that will be tried as a password to break into your account. So knowing what a weak password is can help you learn what a strong password is. It's basically anything that's not a weak password. So follow some simple rules to have a strong password. The first rule is it must be random. It cannot be something that comes out of your head or that you've seen somewhere or it's somehow picked from some source. It's got to be random, and the only way to have a random password is to have the computer generate random characters for you. It's got to be long. 6 characters is not enough. Even 8 is questionable. It should be long. You shouldn't have to worry about memorizing it or typing it, because as we're going to learn in this course, you're going to use a password manager like the one built into Safari to actually generate the password. It's going to remember it for you and it's going to enter it for you. You don't need to ever enter it in. So coming up with a password that's 12 or 16 characters long and it's random and impossible to memorize, that's fine. That's a strong password and that's what you should be using. Also unique. Never use the same password twice. Never use it at 2 different sites. Never repeat using that same password. And then as a bonus, in addition to that, also use as many different characters as you can. Of course, use letters, but upper and lower case, and numbers, and also many symbols are accepted for passwords like dashes and such. The more different characters you use, the stronger the password will be. So how do you get a strong password? So I've already mentioned this. There's really only one way to do it right, and that's have a random password generated by your computer. And we're going to learn in this course how to use Safari to have a random password generated. But there are also many third-party password managers like 1Password and LastPass that will generate random passwords for you, remember them, and enter them in for you automatically. Anything less, anything that you come up with or that you can easily memorize because it's short enough or type like that, is not going to be a strong password and is going to make your computer, your devices, and your online accounts vulnerable to attack.
If you like this video, click the thumbs up button below to let me know. I publish new tutorials each weekday. Hit the subscribe button so you don't miss out.